I want to tell you a real quick story about fresh eyes, that thing Michael was talking about. In America, a couple of years ago, a science teacher gave his high school class this assignment. He said, think of a way of saving the school money. 15-year-old boy called Sevier Merchandani thought about all the handouts they use. They were still using a lot of paper handouts, notes to go home to parents. And he thought about all the ink. And he went home and on his computer put 300 words typed on a document, copied it three times. So he had four identical documents. Then he changed the font on each of the four, printed them out, and weighed them. Now, the bits of paper weigh the same, right? Any difference in the amount of weight must be due to the differing amount of ink the different fonts are using. You with me? You got that? Good, good. He found from that analysis that if his school changed from the font they were using to Garamond, and have a look at Garamond next time you're looking at fonts, I love looking at fonts, the letters are a bit thinner, they would reduce their ink bills by 24% and save 21 grand a year. He found if the US government printed everything on Garamond font, they'd save $370 million. A year. Isn't that a great example of fresh eyes? You and I look at fonts every day. We never think about them. This kid looked at them with fresh eyes, saw a way of saving his school money that everyone else was thinking about and no one saw. Now, our next speaker, ladies and gentlemen, is joining us from Melbourne via Zoom, Martijn, Verbree. Martijn has changed the title of his presentation from Disruptive Thinking in Cyber Risk Management to Qantas, How Things Got This Bad. As you heard earlier, he was mucked around by Qantas three times in the last 15 hours, but we're really glad that he could make it today. And he will be able to do a Q&A later with, it was going to be me, but after the last one, everyone's going, ah, we want more Kieran. Let's get Kieran in. Kieran's better than you. So Kieran's going to do it. Great, Kieran. Happy for you. Martijn is a partner, national cyber lead at KPMG Australia, specialises in cybersecurity and digital risk management, delivered cybersecurity and risk transformation programs across financial services, manufacturing, many more, led and delivered 100 cybersecurity engagements. He's going to share insights and knowledge to help you strengthen your security measures, educate your customers to be cybercrime wise. Martijn, take it away. Great to have you.
Thank you so much, everyone, and pleasure to be there virtually. Really disappointed not to be there in physical form. I was never a big fan of the metaverse until 24 hours ago, so I'm just pretending to be in the metaverse from now, and I'll pick the metaverse above a Qantas flight anytime from now on. I'll be talking a little bit about disruptive thinking in cyber risk management, and the reason for that is I think we've gone a little bit stale when we talk about cyber risk ourselves, particularly how we manage it and how we can do something about it. We've become very compliance driven rather than actually disruptive in our thinking about what we can tackle, what we can do to tackle the emerging threat. I'm going to try to move a slide from my phone, and it works, crikey. I'm connected to two devices to this presentation at the moment, and so far no cyber attacks on me, so this is all working fine. A picture of a ship. The eagle-eyed amongst yourselves probably know what I'm going to cover in the next minute or so. This ship belongs to a company called Maersk from Denmark, the biggest container shipping company in the world. And they had a huge cyber outage in 2017 caused by a malware called NotPetya. And why do I bring this up? This is almost the September 11 equivalent for us in the cybersecurity space. The stuff that we were thinking about was sort of part of movies, and we were always telling CIOs and CEOs that they need to look out for and watch out for and give us funding to fix cybersecurity, had never happened really at this scale until 2017. So what happened? What started off as a geopolitical experiment, a kind of an attack between most likely Russia and Ukraine, very topical, spilled over onto Maersk, who was operating from from Ukraine, from one of their offices. And within 24 hours, their entire IT infrastructure was wiped, was taken down. 50,000 different laptops, endpoint servers, all had to be rebuilt from scratch. And this was a huge outage that has never seen before. Any company has never seen anything like it. And if you just imagine what it would be like to actually be part of that company at the time, you can't use your address book to email someone that something is wrong. It doesn't exist anymore. You can't use your voice over IP system. Everything was down. They were using WhatsApp to dock ships around the world. And it was purely because of the workforce really trying to work out what they had to do and the culture that they really got over this this big incident. Many companies would have ceased to exist after an attack like that. And it took many months to restore everything, and it costed, of course, lots of dollars as well. But for the first time, it made us think, because it became real, and we have seen, of course, this sort of stuff happen many times a year nowadays. It's not necessarily wiper software or malware that we saw in the Maersk case. It's evolved to what we call ransomware and so on. And pretty much every week you open the paper and there's something in there. I do think that Australia has been a lucky country, by the way, so far. We haven't seen anything this scale here, this side of the planet, which could either be the cyber criminals and the nation states are not very interested in us, or we have extremely well fit for purpose cyber defenses. And I'll leave it up to you which one it is. And it's not just cybersecurity that we see this stuff in. A year after Maersk, this was in the UK. I lived in the UK for 13 years, so a lot of my stories will be very much based on what we see over there. A year after Maersk, one of the big banks over there, TSB, for those who know it, was taken over by Sabadell, a Spanish bank. And as part of their upgrades, they wanted to move every customer off their basically core banking system to Sabadell's banking system, and it went horribly wrong. For weeks, people couldn't access their bank accounts. There was a system-wide outage. ATMs weren't working, and at the same time, we saw people queuing up to get money. It wasn't quite a bank run, but it was pretty bad. In the UK, we've got this concept of cobra meetings, where basically cabinet comes together with experts to discuss matters that affect the country. Several cobra meetings were being held on actually the situation around TSB. After a few weeks, all was migrated, okay, but the cause in the incident wasn't so much a cyber attack. It was basically a colossal failure of human error and lack of testing, but it made us think. It made us think very much about, well, actually, we're seeing cyber attacks, we're seeing outages, we're so dependent on our technology at the moment, and we can see actually what disruption this is bringing to us as a society. So we probably need to think a little bit differently about how we do things. So today, what I'll cover off is probably five things. I'll cover off a little bit of response to what we're seeing in terms of regulatory changes coming in from overseas. I'll focus a little bit on the UK, because I think Australia always looks very closely to what is happening in the UK, and you can see some of the spillover already coming here. I'll focus on why we need to think differently about our resilience, RT resilience, in the context of cyber attacks. It's really about survival these days as a company rather than dealing with pesky IT outages. In order to combat that, we need to be more disruptive in our thinking and how we deal with cybersecurity. And I'll give you four or five examples of what we're seeing happening on the other side of the planet. And I'll talk to you a little bit about the missing link in cyber. It's not as exciting as you think it is, by the way. So that's my spoiler alert for that one. And lastly, if there's time, I'll try to cover off some of the evolution of the various lines of defense we're seeing. First line, second line, third line are probably concepts that you've heard of. So in terms of legislative changes, what we saw in banking in the UK, I'm not going to spend time on PSD2 and open banking. I think you heard quite a bit about it this morning, and GDPR. They're sort of done as far as the Europeans are concerned. We're living with it, although it's probably fair to say that PSD2 hasn't quite brought the innovation yet that we expected. But the big controls up left for us was really the multi-factor authentication, so the step of authentication as part of payments. So that has been a huge improvement. And GDPR, well, that's why we have all these beautiful cookie and consent banners these days when you hit a European website. Looks like my slide is gone actually from my screen, but hopefully you can still see it in the room. One of the key things that we have in over there is a lot of legislation has come in around cybersecurity. Actually, in 2014, the Bank of England has realized that we need to do something different there about cybersecurity to protect the banking industry, and they've taken a slightly different approach than APRA, what they're doing over here, what we are doing over here. They started to mandate. Three times a year, every financial institution needs to do a penetration test or a threat intelligence-led assessment. What that is, basically, three times a year, you need to hire a bunch of hackers to hack your company and really look at the results and take action after that. And that's really moved the needle, I think, for financial services. Rather than compliance-based checklists and actions, it's really brought us home by actually where the rubber meets the roads, how do these attackers come in. They're using the same techniques as the nation states and the cyber criminals, and it's boosted the state of cybersecurity quite forward over there. The flavor of the day is not so much cybersecurity, it's probably much more around operational resilience. And legislation is being put in as we speak. The big financial service institutions, including payment providers, they have to map out what their important business services are. Bit similar to what we have here in Australia with the SOCI legislation that is coming in. What is the stuff that we do as a payment provider or as a financial institution that is critical to us as a functioning society? And obviously, payment processes are a key part of that. So that is happening as we speak. Most institutions are being asked to actually define impact tolerances. So what are their tolerances around these things actually not working or being out? And this is actually where we see a lot of deviation between the various institutions. And I expect we're going to see a lot more guidelines from Bank of England, at least, about actually what we need to be worried about. Is it your customers? Is it the corporate customers? Is it us as citizens? Is it as a functioning society? But it's taking a lot of focus from the financial institutions. And with SOCI and some of the things we heard this morning from Scott Farrell, we're going to expect to see a lot more focus on this over here as well. So for yourselves and the audience, it is very much around how do we survive a big attack if it happens and when it happens. Moving down a little bit, critical third parties. One of the key things that is driven overseas is really not just the reliance on those, the critical services themselves, but also on the third parties who help you maintain those. So as a payment provider, as a bank, who actually is critical to you delivering your service in the first place and is taking that to the next level, and who are their third parties and their third parties as well. And we're going to see a lot more discussion papers and consultancy papers coming out over that. And it's absolutely going to hit these shores here as well. So don't just think about your service that you deliver yourself and what you need to do to keep online, but who you're dependent on in your ecosystem to make sure that can continue to happen. The last piece of big legislation that's coming in is what we call SOX UK. This is very much financial reporting driven in the US. For those who know it, UK is choosing a similar sort of regime now for every listed company in the UK. And the key thing is that it's probably, I want to call out here, is that it doesn't apply just to your internal controls over financial reporting. It also applies to cybersecurity controls and your resilience controls. And in fact, the legislation is going to go as far as that you need to have, if you operate over there and you're listed, you will need to have your operational resilience statement that you have in your annual report also be independently verified that is actually all in place. So big focus on resilience, and I'll explain a bit more on why that is. So the move that we're seeing really with Maersk and with this big dependency on our critical systems is really that it's no longer about incidents or small data losses or outages. It's about survival of the company as a whole. If everything is gone overnight and you can't bring this back online in a reasonable amount of time, at some point in time, you're going to run out of money, customers, and so on. So we really need to challenge ourselves. If the worst happens to us as a company and we are being breached by cyber attack or maybe something else, how will we survive? How do we actually rebuild our company from scratch? And what order would we do this in? the key reasons why we're not surviving right now is that a lot of business continuity plans that we have in disaster recovery are just no longer fit for purpose for those big outages, those big breaches. It's very often modeled after natural or physical disasters and small IT issues. It's not modeled after the survival of you as a company. The second thing that we're seeing is the world, of course, is changing digitally much, much faster than 24 months ago. I was listening full of fascination to the previous speaker about the metaverse, and I can't wait to see what the first big cyber incidents are going to be taking the metaverse down, or your digital company in the metaverse. So we're connecting things much faster, and what we're seeing, for example, in the operational technology world is in Iran, for example, a few weeks ago, a few big iron smelters were suffering from a cyber attack. We can probably all guess that it wasn't a financial crime gang doing it, but probably a nation state. We can probably guess which one. But they had liquid hot iron spilling over on the floors. And one, without a miracle, there were no casualties. But we're seeing that these things are being connected increasingly digitally. And my philosophy is still, when things can go boom, you probably shouldn't connect it to the internet at this point. The next wave of cyber attacks will be stronger, faster, and more destructive. Yeah, you can bet on that. A lot of what we saw 5 years ago, 10 years ago, that was sort of in the realm of really top-level nation states doing, is now spilling over to financial crime gangs operating in all parts of the world, and they're copying a lot of their techniques. At the same time, a lot of our IT or cyber protect, detect, and respond capabilities are no longer fit for purpose. Very much they are still based on long lists of controls that we need to do. Think about CPS 234 if you're in banking, or PCI DSS you probably have heard of, NIST as a beautiful list of 300 controls. But what they do is they turn the art of cybersecurity a little bit into a compliance art, rather than actually really thinking about what can go wrong and what do we do about it. And a few key examples are really that most organizations are still shaped like an egg. An egg that is hard on the inside may have a few cracks, but once you're inside, for an attacker, it's actually quite easy to move around. And we have very limited segmentation and zoning. And we need to rethink a little bit how we actually organize ourselves and how we do better there. Also, when we take that compliance approach, we are really looking at these hundreds of controls that we need to implement according to the PCIs, the DSSs, the CPS 234s, and so on. But actually, a lot of these controls are sort of operating at an entity level. But when you really think about it, they need to really apply to the next level down. So if you have hundreds of systems that you rely on, or dozens, to deliver your critical service, you're going to get a multiplication of controls times system. And all these controls, they need to work 24/7, 365 days a week. And most organizations are just not set up to do anything like that that comes close to it. And last but not least, is a lot of our current cyber thinking is based on bell curves, Gaussian statistics, and Gaussian risk management. The problem is with these really disruptive attacks that we've seen with Maersk, they are very fat-tailed, as we call it, in risk management. So they can have huge consequences, and they basically make the average attack look like something quite tiny. And that's one of the key things that a lot of our risk modeling hasn't really taken into account. So therefore, we need to think a little bit differently about how we do cybersecurity today. So what is a disruptive thinking that's required? I've got five nice examples that are my favorites. These are collections that actually are coming over from oil and gas industry overseas, and also some of the larger dot-coms that we've been working with. The first one is what I call, let's think about a last resort barrier. And that is basically taking the assumption that you will be breached at some point in time through a crafty phishing email, or through someone leaving an unprotected piece of equipment on your intranet open to the internet. What do we do when that is being breached, actually? What is the last thing that we want to do to prevent a complete meltdown of our company? And actually, that is often a disconnect. The best defense when something is about to go happen. That is terrible. You disconnect everything from the internet and you almost do a full shutdown. And one of the cool things we're seeing is that a lot of companies in oil and gas are actually treating some of their big plans or their key critical processes as zones. And what they're doing is they are putting little devices in that we call canaries, as in the canary in the coal mine. And what these devices do, in a way, they emulate, they pretend to be something really interesting. So when an attacker is in your network, they see something that says, hey, payment server or Active Directory. But it's not a real thing. It's actually just a little device that's pretending to be that. When an attacker tries to breach that, because they may have already a username and password combination that they want to try on that, the canary will detect it, will send an alert out, and then you can do something with it. Because at that point, you actually know that someone's in your network touching things that they shouldn't be touching. And the most sophisticated implementation of this that I've seen is at that moment, there will be an automatic full shutdown of the plants or the network or the domain. And that's a really big thing. If you're in IT operations, you probably shiver of the idea, but that automatically, without human intervention, the entire network can go down based on a certain trigger. But that is the thinking that is happening right now, because a reboot and bringing everything back online is 10 times, 100 times easier than a full recovery and rebuild of every system that you have. The second trend that we're seeing is really around if the worst has happened and you've had a meltdown and your systems are no longer available, how can we bring this stuff back quickly so we can resume our business? And we call them, or I call them, islands of recoveries. So it's almost like your critical processes, whether it's your critical payment process, all your machines, all your software, your hardware and your data and your people that you need to run that, try to segment them off in a little island and have a copy of that island at all times on standby. This is not disaster recovery. This is not a backup. This is actually something that is almost sitting in permafrost, if you like. So it's frozen solidly. We keep it up to date, but nothing can get in there until we really need it. But when the disaster strikes, we can bring it back online in a matter of hours or maybe a few days, rather than waiting for many, many months before this can be restored. Little side note, the number one reason that companies are paying the ransomware fee when they have been hit by ransomware attack is not because they haven't got backups. The reason is because it takes too long to recover the systems themselves manually. And by hoping to get the decryption key and paying the ransom, they're hoping to bring things back to life quicker than a complete rebuild. The Islands of Recovery is actually designed to rebuild everything from scratch really, really quickly, so you don't have to worry about actually paying any ransomware or any ransom. The third example is one of my favorites, extreme testing. And it's actually been championed by Netflix, not the TV series, but actually the company themselves. And we've seen it in place at a lot of the tech companies. Basically what they do is every server that they have, every machine that they have on a network has a little piece of code on it that randomly shuts it down at certain intervals. Now, why would you do that? It's basically to make sure that you can rebuild things really quickly. It's to make sure that your IT teams, your product teams, think about these scenarios that actually this thing can just be wiped out overnight. What do we do to bring things back? And how do we build resilience in by design? In a Netflix example, they call it their chaos monkey, but it's actually being used in real life and randomly. Every time of the day, just randomly servers are being switched off at different intervals, and they are being rebuilt automatically without human intervention. And it's just to make sure that actually we are able to withstand a proper sophisticated attack. A variation of that is number four, rebuilding every server every 24 hours. It's something that one of my clients does. So every server gets pretty much wiped every 24 hours and completely rebuilds itself. Question is, why would you do this? Well, there's a few reasons for doing that. Number one is you don't need to worry about patching anymore or vulnerability scanning, because if you rebuild your system every 24 hours, you'll apply the latest patches and so on. It also means that if an attacker has got a foothold on a server, they've got maximum 24 hours to do something with it, and then actually the server's been wiped, including their little footprint on it as well. So it means that they have to start all over again. a really crafty way of building cybersecurity and by design. But it almost contradicts everything you've learned in IT to actually keep your network up and running and build it without any of these sort of drastic measures. The last one is much more of an approach around full complementary prevention and detection. When you look at all the standards that we have around cybersecurity, a lot of it is designed to prevent bad things from happening, but then also detect it when bad things happen. But they're not necessarily aligned. We have on the left-hand side, we've got all these preventative controls, as we call them, which could be things like multi-factor authentication, VPNs, access management, and so on. And on the right-hand side, we've got detective technology, like your security operations center, intrusion detection systems, and so on. But often they're put in isolation. So we put a few things over there and we put a few things over there. This is actually taking an approach that every control that I have that prevents something from bad happening, when that fails, how do I pick it up over there? So when I forget to remove a lever from the systems that was terminated, how do I pick it up as quickly as possible after I forgot to do that? And that it requires almost a rethink about how we actually manage these controls end to end. So what's the big missing link in cybersecurity? And it's really that boring piece. We need to bring risk and controls back into cybersecurity. We've been surrounded by amazing technology, both on the attacker side and on the defender side. And we have been engineering lots of things and making steadily improvements. We've got standards like the Essential 8 that we're probably implementing and so on. But what we haven't done is really thought about what actually the risks are and what do we prevent, what can prevent these risks from happening? How can we detect them? And actually, what do we do if they do happen? How can we bring things back online? We're often doing this in our profession in silos. And this is a little framework that I encourage you to ask your cybersecurity squads about. Have they got something similar that picks this? Or is it just a set of technologies that they have? It's quite simplistic in the way how it's designed. We've got the key threats on the left-hand side. And I think actually these threats that I've got over there, they're probably all your threats, to be honest. There's lots of variations of those ones. But when we go through them from top to bottom, it's the sophisticated, often nation-state based attack that is probably at the top. Now, you may not be a target of this. You may be quite uninteresting for nation-state as a company. However, if you do things like critical infrastructure payments, you most likely are or shortly will be. One of my clients in Europe was booking.com, a big accommodation broker provider. And they actually were a huge target of nation state attacks a number of years ago and probably still so. And the reason why that is because people of national interest to certain regimes, they use booking.com to book their travel. So actually by knowing where people are in the real world, if it travels to booking.com, they can do certain things with those people. And so you may not think actually you're of interest of any nation state. That is probably a false assumption and do that assessment. And we do very different things to protect ourselves from nation states. It's almost impossible to prevent, but then what can we do to actually detect some of that stuff happening and how can we recover really quickly? Going down the list, yes, there's the common attack, very much ransomware driven at the moment. That's the stuff that hits the newspaper. But what we're actually seeing is that what we call unhelpfully in cybersecurity, the business email compromise attack is actually much getting much more popular than ransomware. The reason why that is that a lot of organizations have been taking their measures against ransomware. If you do the Essential 8, you're in a pretty good spot actually to counter some of the common attacks. And what criminals do, they are ruthless entrepreneurs. They have budgets and bosses too, all like all of us. They just pivot the way how they make money. So rather than deploying ransomware, which is quite hard to do, they revert back to impersonating someone from your company. They may hack your CFO or COO's email box and try to persuade your payments team to make a certain payment to a certain bank account. And that actually is still a very lucrative way of making money and a very different cyber risk than the first one. The other ones are data theft. The insider attack is obviously still very, very prevalent. We're seeing that quite a bit of that as well. Financial crime gangs are reverting to that, basically paying call center staff. It's happening actually a lot in the phone, in the telco industry, whereby people are being paid a certain sum of money to do some SIM swapping and so on. And therefore, basically, they're bribing an insider that's already working for you to do certain dodgy things. The human error we talked about, that is the TSB example. Third-party compromise we've talked about as well. And last but not least is the hacktivist, which is basically a slightly different type on doing data breaches. It's more to not disrupt the company, but more to sort of put some graffiti on your website, if you like, or on your Facebook site or your metaverse site. So all these threats, they will likely affect you in some way or form. And it's important to really then take the next step. What is the risk of that actually happening to you as an organization? And again, I think there's probably only four risks that you have at the top level. Many organizations just have cyber risk as one big blob with a high likelihood and a high impact in the top right corner, invests lots of money in it over years. It doesn't go down, and boards and executive management are now asking, like, why is it not going down? You probably need to double click on that risk, the cyber risk, and you probably end up with these four that we have over here. The number one is probably the loss of your critical service. So losing your ability to process payments or to bank or to, if you're an energy provider, to deliver power to people's homes. So that is a really big one. And that was pretty much what happened to Maersk. And we've seen quite a lot of examples actually of ransomware taking a critical service down. The next one is the loss of your enterprise IT services. Not as disruptive as the first one, but can still be pretty, pretty nasty. You lose the ability to do your emails, maybe process your staff changes, do finance and invoices out and so on. And often the route actually into your critical service is through that enterprise layer. So often what we see is an enterprise IT environment be compromised before it moves into the critical service and it takes things down. The third one is loss of data. So basically, you lose a bunch of data that is either personal data, so therefore becomes a regulatory issue under the privacy legislation, or it could be a bunch of IP that is sensitive that that financial criminals can use to make money off. And last but not least is really the you lose funds, like in the business email compromise scenario, whereby someone impersonates someone else to make a big payment, or you lose integrity around your transactions, and both are equally bad. But it comes down to probably those four. So think about with your teams, like what threats do we have based on where we operate? What is the risk for our company? How long can we go without a critical service before our company actually goes under? Then we've got all these beautiful controls that are now almost flat lists as part of the standards. And you see a few examples here. A key thing how to organize these controls and think about this actually is along something that we call in cybersecurity the kill chain. The kill chain is something that's really simple in a way. It's pretty much a blueprint of how every cyber attack in a nutshell works. So they usually start with getting access to one PC. They basically try to get administrative access to the PC and elevate their privileges. They move around, they avoid being detected. They eventually plant their malware, their wiper, steal the data, whatever it is that they want to be, and then they leave. But pretty much every attack follows some sort of path. And the various controls that we have actually that prevent these things will actually help a lot to prevent those steps. So it's really about rethinking a little bit, how do we organize these controls as a flat list and as a tick box exercise? How can we develop the defense in depth that prevents and makes life as hard as possible for attackers to move around? And especially around common attacks, usually after a week or 2 weeks, they will give up and they move on to an easier target. Nation state, they have a lot more patience. They can be in your network for many, many years before they even pop up. So therefore, you probably don't want to spend too much on prevention, but really about detection and resilience, which is the pinky side stuff on the right-hand side. And that is probably the focus of a lot of the legislation that is coming in. When the worst happens and an attacker is able to do step 1 to 5 and do that dodgy thing, how do we recover from this, and what do we need to do differently to make sure that it's not just going to be a 3 months recovery exercise. So putting the controls back into cybersecurity is probably the boring bit, but it should force ourselves to really rethink how we do this.
I'll just do a spontaneous, what do you call it? You know, he says, I says. Except he's not moving his lips anymore, so it's going to be very difficult. Hey? Oh, yeah. I don't know. Seems so obvious. It's not the mute button, is it, Martijn? You haven't got
it. Is the mute button. Oh my God. It's, yeah, it was. I did click something. Apologies.
Thank you, Emily.
I tried to go to the next slide. Technology, right? Technology. I hope everybody can hear me again. I think the last thing I wanted to cover was the lines of defense. And if you're in risk management or an auditor, you're probably familiar with this. It's basically the way how we structure our defenses. And it's a bit like a rugby team with various lines of defense that make sure that nothing falls through the cracks. What about it? What is changing there? And I think the bottom line is that we're seeing much more responsibility move to the first line. The first line is basically your business team. It's your colleagues at the front of the service that you run. It's the IT teams, it's the tech teams, and so on. And historically, a lot of the risk was being managed by your risk team, your risk department, or even worse, the audit teams. And we're seeing a lot more responsibility actually flow towards the first line, which is very good. A lot of security engineering is taking place there now. We're surrounded by great technology, and that has been moving the needle, especially against some of the common attacks. But the big thing that's still missing is we're still lacking that sort of ownership of these controls in those first lines. So we're seeing it more as a technical solution rather than actually an end-to-end set of controls that prevents the worst from happening. We're often reporting controls reports back. It's often done in silos. It's done by risk teams, auditors once a year, and so on. And as a result, we waste a lot of time doing manual checks and balances of how these controls are working and whether or not they are working in the first place. And very often, it's still that the third line, your auditors are still very often the primary source of any assurance around some of your cyber controls. And we love to see that move more into the first line, which is happening very slowly overseas. Now, what about your risk teams themselves? The travel direction is there to become a bit more agile rather than chasing whether you have implemented a certain compliance standard. We will see controls testing done actually more by the first line to make sure that everything is working, which basically then frees the risk teams up to actually really think about the truly highest risk and what we can do about it. They should be your partner. They should be helping you out with prioritizing the risk based on what you try to do as an organization and where you want to put your money to prevent bad things from happening. And last but not least, around the third line, I think what we need to do from an audit point of view, we need to drive a bit of a controls revolution. Controls are, cyber security controls are still very much boring. They're paper, they're flat listed. We need to rethink how we implement 300 of those controls across the board. What are the super controls that we have actually that will really prevent these attacks from happening? Can we automate them? So can we actually have a control as code rather than as a piece of paper or a manual process or a manual checklist? Can we then actually test these controls, whether they're working as part of the build? And last but not least is any control failures that we may have or any controls that are manual are really bad controls, and we should treat control incidents control failures as a proper cybersecurity incident at the same level. If something hasn't worked in those control sequence that I just showed on one of the previous slides, we should really treat it as a proper incident and see, has anything bad happened? Has anything been exposed? Has an attacker got a foothold? Rather than writing it in an audit report with a remediation date of 6 months in the future. That's it. That's what I was wanted to cover. I hope audio was okay, and I'm happy to take some Q&A now.
Back on thing. Thanks for that. It's always hard to do it remotely. You get Mute Button of the Year Award.
Thank you.
I was hoping to go through 2 days without saying you're on mute, but well done. Well done. I could hear some family in the background as well. Is that right?
Yeah. They're away.
Look after them. We've got about 10 minutes, and we stand between lunch and where I am at the lectern. So I'll check for questions from the audience. But as usual, I've got a few. Sadly, I mean, you mentioned some great global brands there, and sadly, some data leakages and things. And for those of you in the room who you pick up your phone after this and you go, look, I don't know that person. Who's that? And then there rings from Singapore, Bendigo, Perth, you name it. You can always trace it back to one of those data leaks. So booking.com, there was a couple of hotel chains. If ever you booked into a hotel, I know Sean, our CFO, is just a legend at getting online and doing that. Guess what? His phone rings about 3 months later saying, Sean, we want you back. Mind you, his daughters steal enough money from him, so he doesn't need cyber people. I just want to touch on the stuff that Martin's gone through today is really important from a licensing perspective. So, you know, if you're a bank, you know, we've got all sorts of standards on cyber and tech and controls that you need to follow. For the new licensing regime that'll come out from Canberra, the same thing applies. So if you're thinking of getting into that space, thinking of license applications, the cyber used to be sort of the last 10 questions at the end. They're now bringing that up front. So, and particularly for your supply chain. So think, it's not just, you know, Christian, I'm looking at you. You know, when you're going down the license path, you'll be coming back at us and saying, please answer all these cyber questions. So this is really important stuff. So I'll kick off with a question, Martijn. The biggest thing to invest in, I mean, I know we've probably touched on people, controls, et cetera, but you know, the question you often get from a board is just, you know, where's the next dollar need to be spent? And I noticed Evan's taken a note about server wipes every 24 hours. That would be a real delta change for most businesses in this room. But is it the technology? Is it the war for talent? I mean, everybody's after an extra 100 cyber people in government. So I guess I'll pose that as the first question.
Yeah, no, look, the cliche is probably true. I would invest in your people. So that's probably the key thing that will drive everything. So investing in your people, whether it's poaching people from your competitor, I don't know if that's a good idea. I think invested in training, raising the bar, awareness, and so on, that will go the longest way, and it's probably the most sustainable thing you can do. If you were to able to pick a technology and so on, and you haven't done already, putting multi-factor authentication on for your clients, for your employees, is probably the best thing you can do if you haven't done already. That removes that data loss angle that you just highlighted, right? So all these leaked passwords that you can find everywhere, it puts an extra barrier in for an attacker.
Yeah. Now, you've got kids at home. One of the questions I often get, and our tech people get, is you got all these kids at home, they're on devices, they're on social media, you name it. What's the one thing you do around cyber at home?
The one thing I do with cyber, okay, so the biggest thing I do is I use a password manager. So I use a password manager. You can pick your favorite one. I
like
use
Norton's
LastPass. Yeah, exactly. And the reason why I do that is because we all have 20 up to 100 passwords we have to remember. We write them down. There's a few super passwords in there. So the one that controls your personal email box and so on. Use a password manager. It creates strong, long passwords for you. It automatically fills it in. Yes, you're going to put all your passwords in one basket, but the idea is that you can protect that basket a lot better than having it on sticky notes and trying to remember.
Good point. So, not a promotion or anything, but we use Norton's. It's very, you know, across the family, it's pretty good. Because all your passwords, if you've got your kids linked to your Apple or your other devices, they've got your passwords. So if their phone gets hacked, the rest is history.
And they click on all the links they can click on. So there's that.
Yeah. It never stops my daughter buying stuff. Standards around the world, are we going to see some sort of harmony from the regulators? I know talk to each other about bits and pieces, but they're more on the threat landscape. So are we going to see any harmony, particularly for those in the room that are sort of have global businesses? Otherwise, you end up setting up teams around the world to sort of feed the regulators.
Yeah, I genuinely hope so, but it's been very slow. It's been slow for decades. We are moving in a bit of harmony, I think. I think we largely agreed on the things you need to be in place, whether it's essential aid, whether it's PCI, DSS, they overlap 80%. So I think we're getting there. That said, I think it's slower than the developments in this space. When you think about a lot of the legislation was written before MERSC, basically, and was sort of written for smaller incidents. We're now in a different worlds, and especially when you think about metaverse, what's that going to do? It's always going to be lagging behind in a way, but we're making good steps in the right direction. What I would do, if you're in the room and you know that these legislations are coming, have a look at them now and start working towards it. Don't treat it as a compliance thing after it's come into place, because then you're already too late.
The thing around the metaverse, I know you touched on it earlier, but the principles don't change in the metaverse, do they?
No.
It's just a virtual world you've still got to apply. So if anybody's thinking of being in there for recruiting or, you know, meeting structures or whatever else, you know, it's just an extension of what your framework should do.
Yeah, it's a bit like that, right? Although the identity component is really important, because in real life, I still look a bit like this. Whereas in the metaverse, I could be the tiger in the bank branch. And how do you know? I could be that cat that little
funny video. You can pick your own avatar.
Yeah, exactly. It becomes a lot easier to pretend to be someone else. You can create so many different identities. You can target on a much larger scale as well. So we're going to have some serious thoughts about how do we actually prove who you are in the metaverse and that you're dealing with a legitimate company. So that's probably the biggest thing that I'm scratching my head on. Like, how do we make sure we solve for that?
Okay. I might pause, check the audience. We've got one over here. Thanks. One from the audience, Martijn.
Thanks for a really great talk. I'm Neil McAvoy from Consult Hyperion, and we tend to classify security as, you know, CIA, confidentiality, integrity, and availability. And I think most of your remarks were kind of directed on availability, perhaps because you see that as the kind of the biggest problem right now. But would you like to comment on the other two aspects?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And look at that, and the CIA is it's sort of the old school mantra, right? You need to determine what your risk profile is along those three. I think availability is the one that's really shocked us. Confidentiality and integrity was always a big thing anyway for financial statements audits, and especially when you were in your world around transaction integrity and so on. Then privacy became a big thing, and then we were more worried about confidentiality. I think right now it's the availability that is really the bit that will put your organization at a huge risk. If you can't deliver your critical service, the key thing that you make your money on for an extended period of time because you've been taken out, that's hard to recover from. That's really hard to recover from. And that's what brings your survival at risk. Big data losses, yeah, terribly inconvenient. Big fines, especially in Europe. But your company wouldn't be at stake necessarily. And the transaction monitoring is a huge thing, especially in payments worlds. But I like to think that we've solved most of that by now.
Yeah, thanks for that. I've got one over here.
Yeah, Eric Fenner, PNN Bank. Question really, Martijn, is actually for Kieran on the Cuscal side. I think your statement, Martijn, where you said BCP and DR are no longer fit for purpose is kind of scary. And I know that Cuscal had a big epiphany about 4 years ago or so when you had your power outage and lost, among other things, your password manager. How seriously are you taking this statement now about BCP and DR no longer being fit for purpose? And how do we in the room who are all clients of yours have that confidence that we do have? How do we continue to have that confidence that you are not going to be our weak link?
Yeah, thanks for that. Sorry, Martijn, you can take a break for a second.
I'll make some notes.
A couple of things. Where's Louise? Is she around? No, she's actually out, but Evan's there. So the first, we're looking at it very differently, and very differently to what we did 4 years ago. The first thing is it's front and center on our executive risk committee and our board and board risk committee, and Evan and Louise, our CISO, attends those meetings. We had some APRA reviews last year, and we sort of met those standards, but it really caused us to think, what's the next step up? We've actually got another consulting, we've got an external consultant who's done this for a lot of people coming to talk to us He'll have about a two-month exercise, I think. And we're going to play that back with APRA. So we're actually working with APRA in tandem about what that new standard set looks like. We don't get caught by the Critical Infrastructure Act, but you know what? We're going to do it anyway. So, which is, I think they've started at $10 billion plus, which is the big banks and the big super companies, but it'll work its way down. So we've really taken, Evan and I and the leadership team have taken the view that that's, you know, if you, it's in our top 10 risks, take a different view on it. And I think Martijn touched on it before. We probably had that one button which said cyber, and we're now blowing that out a bit, and it involves BCP, auto recovery, et cetera, et cetera. So, and I think Evan, at some stage after the review, we probably had headed towards a webinar with our clients to sort of share those learnings. So, and Eric will put you down for the first conversation. So, thank you for that. That's a good question. The time is blinking at me. Martijn, I'd just like to thank you again, because remote, you had three Qantas fails. I think James is going to politely work that into this afternoon. So don't worry, we're here as your proxy this afternoon to give that feedback to one of the Qantas directors. But again, thank you. And just if you can join with me in thanking Martijn.
Thank you very much, Kieran. Great job again. You're making me nervous, how good you are. Yes, eloquently put. And Martijn, if you can still hear me less eloquently, we'll smash them for you. We'll smash Qantas this other. Todd Sampson, 5-minute presentation, 40-minute questions. We've just rejigged it a little bit. Lunch now, and you get nearly 50 minutes of lunch, thanks to Visa, the sponsor, of course. Don't forget to tweet and LinkedIn and all that stuff if you want to.